Well, first, thanks to the organizers for the opportunity to speak here. And this is a joint work in progress with Shiv Chandra-Guinet for the organizer, Anne-Otienne, and Emmanuel Wagner, who are both in the room, and will answer any of your questions. So a word of context first. So this is part two of a project we have to generalize the work of Kovanov and Zeidel. And the paper of the year 2000, in which they had, so as just Susan was speaking about yesterday, an algebraic categorization of the classical paper, a proof of its baselessness. And then there was also a symplectic monogramming. And so the two first parts were already done in our first paper. And what I want to talk about today is the strategy for generalizing this symplectic monodromy map to the case of the break group of the cylinder or extended break group of a finite type A. And so the theorem I want to speak about, and give my here of the proof. Is the following, that for any n bigger than 3, b bigger than 2, there exists a symplectic manifold m, no, n d omega of dimension, real dimension, 2d. And a symplectic monodromy map so that that goes from this extended break group of a finite A into the group of connected components of the symplectic morphism group of this symplectic manifold, naturally with compact support. And moreover, this map is injective. And it was already contained in German, the introduction of this paper, that this can be translated in a more up-to-date technology with Fourier categories and a categorical action, symplectic categorical action. And we can do the same here. So, and usually in talks in front of geometry groups, I usually apologize to speak about categories, but here is the right place to do that. So, n equal, n bigger than 3, d bigger than 2, and it's just a pair of that. So, f and d, and the first one, categorical action. Extended break group of the finite on its derived category. So this is a mere translation of what's happening here and setting up the Fourier category. And well, what I still put in stars because I haven't written it properly yet is that F and D should generalized. will talk about this translation because this is the right setting to compare this capital collection to the one we had in our first paper about the algebraic categorification of the break group of the cylinder. So just remind you for comparison. So you might have seen that neither Adol or Emmanuel talked about it before. So in our first paper, we proved that there exists a trick method and an action of the break group of the cylinder on CM, which is faithful. And such that on the perpendicular is a generalization of the Virab representation, so with two parameters. So the hope at the end of our project together, and what will be for the trip, hopefully, is that the two categories are equivalent, so that F and D should be endowed with extra gratings. We have an idea how to do. And the two categories should be proven equivalent, and such that this equivalence intertwines the group action on both sides. So, my plan for today is to remind you a few things about the break group of the cylinder, although you probably know it better than me, but at least it will set up the notations. Then tell you about, well, the syntactic geometry, the definition of the monodromy map, and the idea behind it. Prove that it's injective, and if time allows, to say a few things about today. Yes.
Why you say you write theorem 2017 and the paper on the actual in 2015?
Because I think that's the actual day of publication. Ah. January.
Okay.
But yes. So the writing. So the two first are the classical break group relations. So sigma I, sigma j is sigma I if I j is abelsons. Sigma I, sigma I plus 1, sigma I is sigma I plus 1, sigma I is sigma I plus 1. And then sigma plus 1, sigma I rho, sigma I rho. open mod n, namely the parameters at just k, in the relations, so that you get what for the two first the gray group of a file type A. When you're adding the row, you have this word extended and this extra half. And as you probably know, you can see these as gray group of a cylinder by taking the usual transposition for sigma and one sigma, but this one drawn on a thickened cylinder. And rho corresponds to cyclic permutations of the strands of the strands on the cylinder. There is another description in terms of mapping pathway, which will appear later again. So as mapping class group. So you probably know that the classical gray group with n plus one strands corresponds to the mapping class group of a disk with n plus one point to disk. And as I will be working with symplectic geometry, I actually want to see it as the smooth diffeomorphism, fermentation preserving, of the disk, fixing a set of n plus 1 points which I will label by 0, 1 to here, and preserving the buffer, and that's all up to small size of copies. And you can see the gray group of the cylinder inside this classical gray group. Subgroup of this mapping class group that preserves one of the punctures, so say zero. Is in the center of the disk, and the rest is equally spaced on a circle in the center of the disk, etc. I plus one, and to the generator sigma I, one associate. Something that you can describe like this. So you take a small disk around the punctures I and I plus 1. The segment between them I will call it B I. And you describe a diffeomorphism with support in this red disk. The following there. I plus 1. Line here going through I and I plus 1. This diffeomorphism will turn the disk with an angle pi and will exchange I plus pi. And we'll do on this line the following operation. And this I will call TBI, because it corresponds to the segment BI. And now for the generator row. We take a diffeomorphism with support a smaller disk, and it will rotate with an angle 2 pi over m this interior disk, so that this line will be moved to, so this is not moving, this is not moving. Okay, and this will be C boundary. And this will come up later when I relate it, well, the phase components results. Okay, any questions so far before I move to the synthetic geometry? Kovanov and Weidel are also worked by Ishii, Ueda, who prove categorical action this time of the breakup of the fine type A, is to look at a symplectic manifold that has a nice symplectic vibration over the disk with singularities exactly at the same points as your mapping plasma disk. And with that, somehow built the symplectic image of the generators as somehow lists of the mapping class group generators to the vibration. It's not exactly that, but that's the rough idea. So, in our case, U and D we can take our generalization of what they did in dimension T equal 2, and we can look at them as given an equation x1 and z in C to the D, x star, satisfying the following equation x1 squared and x2 done with a synthetic form, which is the standard synthetic form in the first coordinates. So in each plane coordinate plates, it's just the area form, plus this modified form in the z coordinates, and that corresponds just if you see c star as t star as 1, that would be the standard symplectic form of t star as 1, but just in this way. today to make my life easier with indices, and because you're already proving a symplectic monodromy map in case d equal 2, I will just stick with d equal 2. And in this case, with changes of variables, you can describe it as x, y, z in c2 times t squared, such that t x1 z is z to the minus 1. Just have to make some change of coordinates with x is x plus y over the square root of 2 or the other way around. With the same actually symplectic form. And the nice vibration you will look at is IN. From this manifold to C star given by the projection to Z, to the Z coordinate. And in higher dimension, you really do exactly the same. And this is a Lachesse vibration. So a nice vibration, as I was telling you about. It's certainly not the place for a lecture about Lachesse vibrations, but what you need to know about these nice vibrations is that, so they're nice in multiple ways, they're nice symplectically, holomorphically, and because of their singularities. So if I put on C star the same symplectic form, then the map Pn is omega omega C star exact. In particular, we have outside of the singularity of the singularities symplectic parallel transport maps. So along curves, I can transport in the total space things around with a symplectic map. So synthetic parallel transport map. The second good thing about the vibrations is that with the complex structures in use, it is for these complex structures holomorphic. Which means that you can understand holomorphic objects, and you want to do Fourier categories at the end. You can understand holomorphic objects in the total space by pushing them downstairs on the disk. So that's good to simplify our life. They have isolated singularities, isolated singular forms. And you can always deform that to have that, but here it's for free. They have one in each fiber. And up to change of coordinates, complex change, these singularities in their neighborhood look like, so here with two coordinates, u1, u2, is just quadratic form, and that's specific to the Lachesse vibrations. So these are the best we can hope for somehow. And so here in our case, if you look at the fiber, of the point C, we can just describe to the equations. So E to the minus 1 over 0. You see that there are just quadrics in this dimension. So smooth quadrics, almost always. Except at the singular value, so except when z belongs to this set that I will call delta in the future, which are the nth root of unity. So theta to dk, and theta will be fixed to the exponential. And so what's happening is that you have quadrics, and when you go towards a singular value, to the singular point. This picture is actually accurate, mainly in each, if you're going with an arc from z to zeta k, there is one circle that collapses to the singular point, and that's through the synthetic transformer. So you have a well object here, called the vanishing cycle, just like the algebraic geometry. And it will be VC. And because I chose to change coordinates, I can this equation in our case. So in our case, these BZs are given by the following expression. So, BZ. And XYZ in my opinion, such that the module of X is the module of Y, because I'm in a very symmetric situation. And the general case, so it's always here a d minus 1 sphere. So in the general case, you can also give a formula. So it's just a bit more amount to give it. And these vanishing cycles will help us to describe the very important Lagrangians I'm going to work with. So these Lagrangians will be associated to curves in the distance there, and we'll project to these curves. So first, the curves we considered are called admissible curves. So these are curves that are joining two singular values, or the points in the Lapin class group in the picture before, and avoiding the singular values in between. So they are and smooth. So C, if we can parameterize that as well. So either a disk enclosing all the singular values, or you can always isotope them into the disk, such that the endpoints belong to the critical values, and we are holding the critical values in between. And so to such a C, we associate a Lagrangian LC, which is obtained by taking the union of all the vanishing cycles over this curve. So I can even write a little description in this case. So there will be all the x, y, c of t in W n, such that modulus x is modulus y. And at the endpoints, you see that this formula gives you just 0, 0 and the critical values, zeta of t. And so you can this actually describes the sphere also over the singular points. And what's the picture to have in mind? These spheres, which are called matching spheres. And these are, well, Lagrangian spheres just by constructions, because we're taking Lagrangians in the fibers, so isotropic submanifold, and we just parallel transform. So Lagrangian is for free. They're exact, well, first because they're spheres, so the pullback of the symplectic form is an exact one form. So we're happy when we're working with exact Lagrangians always. And the very important Lagrangian I will work with are actually associated to some nice admissible curves that I already kind of drew when I was writing down the mapping class group descriptions, and that these are the segment BI. So, maybe here. So, theta 0, theta 1, theta 1, theta I. So, I have a second of I. And so, to each, this is the one. Of these BIs, I associate the Lagrangian LBI. And these LBIs, this collection is such that LBI intersection with LBJ is empty if I and J are distant. LBI is intersecting transversely with the R plus 1 in a point. So that's quite a good start to do some reproduction on the symplectic side. So these are the very important Lagrangians because they will help us to build what we associate to the generators, and they will also be test Lagrangian to test the faithfulness of the map. Okay. So now I can explain the symplectic homomorphism. What do we associate to the sigma i's? Well, what Kovanov and Zaidov did for the classical break group, what Ishii Ueda did for the break group of the finite A, to sigma I, we associate the symplectic bend twist associated to this sphere LBI. So what is a symplectic bend twist? Well, each time you have a sphere random inside a symplectic manifold, you can define this symplectic bend twist. And what does it do? So it will be 0.2 LBI. This is called L, the symplectic bend twist. So it is the antipodal map. So, well, first of all, if you look at the neighborhood of L inside M, it is always symplectomorphic, and that's the theorem of Einstein, but still used all the time, to a neighborhood of the zero section of the cotangent bond. And these bend twists are with compact support, and they're actually defined in a neighborhood of the zero section and then put transferred through this symplectomorphism to any symplectic manifold containing this Lagrangian sphere. And how do you describe them on the cotangent bundle? So I will only draw it in dimension 2, so for this one. So this is my L, T star L. So on the Lagrangian itself, on the zero section, it's just the antipodal map. So to a point here, I associate minus the point. And it is with compact support, so it won't do anything outside of this lens. And to a fiber, like this, it will twist it. So it's staying here, and it's twisting here all around, and coming back. And you can actually write formulas. What's happening actually is that you're using the normalized geodesic flow on the cotangent. And it's not defined on the zero section, but you're putting the antipodal map to define it all over. So there are actually smooth parametrization of this. So, as usual, we associate to any of these transposition generators the symplectic day twist, and what we have to do is to find something to associate to rho. LBI plus 1. Unfortunately, it is not looking that support, and for some reason, by the end, you should see, the ones symplectomorphism with compact support. But what's happening is that it's, if you keep this symplectomorphism along the neighborhood of the union of all my spheres, so where the singular points are, well, outside of it, you have this parallel transport map, and you can modify this side to get something with compact support. And this is what I will associate to rho. And I will call it two boundary, just as the mapping class group notations. So now I'm claiming that my map rho s is to sigma I associate the symplectic den twist, to rho I associate t rho, but to have an actual monodromy map, I have to check the Bragg populations. So.
So I need to think that it's a, if you want to fix the boundary of this.
Sorry?
Is it? Sorry. Oh, no, this, well, so okay, so if it fixes the boundary of the disk, it moves the points this way, or
yeah, so
okay,
you have to set it right. So I'm giving here just an idea, but you have to kind of do a big fibration, modify your boundary to keep a nice description.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Okay.
There is something to be done there.
So kind of in the inside of the disk.
So
like
in the
from the boundary it's this map?
So in the neighborhood of the collection of Lagrangian, this
yeah.
necklace of Lagrangians,
uh-huh.
I will do that,
uh-huh.
and then I will modify it very quickly
okay.
outside
okay.
to get the identity outside of the disk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
So yes, what about the Bragg populations? So the Bragg population for the sigma i's, I actually don't have to check because they were already checked by Giovanna Ferreiro and by Chiweda Oera. And so it would be LDI, 2 LDJ is Hamiltonian isotopy to 4 J, 2 LDI. Well, this is easy to check, it's just because, so if I have J, it's just because the spheres are disjoint and your symplectic den twist are local symplectomorphisms, so that you can see quite easily. The other one we have it too. That's a bit more geometric. And we can see it, for instance, in the part as well. And so the only one that is left is T boundary, T LDI, T boundary, this one is T LDI. And so where is this coming from? Well, one of the features of the symplectic den twist is that if I have a diffeomorphism, a symplectic diffeomorphism, and I conjugate the den twist, I get the den twist on the image of the sphere by this symplectomorphism. And well, if you want to be more precise, you have to keep track of what Zeidel call a framing, so somehow the embedding of the sphere in the sphere. But here I can play this game with phi being t rho, and so I know that t rho t LBI t boundary minus 1 is t of the image, which is LBI plus 1. And if you keep track of the framing, there is a small rotation, but it keeps the symplectic den twist, so that you have this Hamiltonian isotopy. So this is also okay. And so indeed, we have a symplectic monodromic map described from the Bragg group of the cylinder inside this Hamiltonian isotopy components of the symplectic group. And now, proof.
So this is actually, so what I didn't appreciate at the beginning, there's two versions of this affine braid group, where you include the row and not.
So the braid group of affine type A is without the row.
Uh-huh.
But with the braid group relation model. Instead of the classical braid group where you have the strands but you don't have the modern thing.
Yeah.
And so for the braid group of affine type A, these people, Ishii, Ueda, have a paper already doing it.
Okay.
Where they mimic what's happening with Kovanov and Zeidel and with the dentist. Mm-hmm. So somehow, well, we had to come up with row.
So the row is...
And with other things that are coming up for the face woman. Matching spheres that are still drawn here, associated to all the LBS. And how do we test it? Well, we test it with flow homology. So, either you know about flow homology, either you won't care. There are a few properties that I will be using: invariance by Hamilton and isotopies, a result about intersection numbers. And I think that's about it. So you can see, also see it as a black box if you don't remember. So let's start. What do we want to do for the injectivity? We want to see that a sigma is an element of this extended affine braid group. And if with true rho of S, we associate, I will take a representative phi sigma in the group of symplectomorphisms. I want to see that this symplectomorphism is Hamiltonian isotopic to the identity. So, a few facts that I will be using. So if you take two admissible curves, C1, C2, well, now it's become classical, but you can just look at what Zeidel did in the Kovanov-Zeidel paper, then the flow homology of the two Lagrangian associated to them is well defined. And the dimension of this homology is equal to 2 times the geometrical intersection number, so a classical thing, between the two curves. So that's the first fact I will be using. And the second fact that you have to check is that if sigma is an element of your group, well, then you can associate with phi sigma. And you can also associate with it what I will call F sigma, which is a mapping class group representative. And so to any admissible curve C, Well, you can look at the Lagrangian associated to LC, and also the image by the Mappinghaus group of the curve C and the Lagrangian associated. And Fatou says that if I take my Lagrangian associated to the curve and I apply to it the symplectic homomorphism associated to sigma, it is Hamiltonian isotopic to the curve associated to the image by the Mappinghaus group of C. So these are the two facts that will be useful. And so now, if I look at my Lagrangian associated to the light, Hamiltonian isotopy invariance of the free homology, and because of fact 2, this is isomorphic to the free homology of LBI L F sigma of EG. Now, by fact 1, the dimension of this is equal to 2 times the intersection of the curve BI and the image by the sigma of the curve BJ. But now if I use the fact that phi sigma, no, what am I saying? If phi sigma is the identity, then sigma was the one element in the group. Sorry. So my assumption is that phi sigma is a Hamiltonian isotopic to the identity. And then, again, by Hamiltonian invariance, this free homology is the same as the free homology of LBI LBJ. And so this dimension is 2 times this geometrical intersection number, but this is also equal to a geometrical intersection number, namely of the BI and the BJ. So at the end of this analysis, I have that for all my j between 1 and 1, the intersection number of IBI IBJ is equal to IBI, the image by F sigma of BJ. And now the next ingredient is something we already used in our first paper to prove the placefulness of the algebraic action. Algebraic categorification. Thank you. sigma is in the center of the brain group of the cylinder, namely sigma is rho to the n to some power, for some in C. So at this stage, if rho is some power of rho to the n, we have already simplified the question, and also phi sigma is the map I associate to rho to the n. So with, well, old-fashioned thermology so far, we already managed to get there and to simplify it. To prove now that sigma is the identity, what I have to prove is P0. And to prove that, I actually have to work with a bit more technology, namely with Lagrangians and spectromorphism that are graded. For those who were there last week, Bianchi has mentioned extensively the importance of gradings and how they change your Fourier category when you change your grading, so you may know that they're important. So, what about the gradings? Very quickly. So, we're in a good case where we can grade our Lagrangians and grade the symplectomorphism we're looking at. And that is done through the holomorphic volume form. Holomorphic volume form. So this group, Ishii, Ueda, Ueda, had already one that is working with this one, which is the residue form of dx, dy, dz over the patient. This one. Yes. So in the chart, say y different to zero, this is like this, dy dz is like z. And so we worked with something more general, and a family of gradings. I will denote omega k, and I will put z to the k in the front. And so with these gradings that I don't have the time to explain, so for fix a k, so for this grading, you can see that this T boundary is graded, and because there is a because we were careful to work with symplectomorphism with compact support, you have a grading, preferred grading for symplectomorphism with compact support that corresponds to the zero shift for the identity at infinity. And so we have a preferred grading for each of the symplectomorphism we're working with. And for this grading, you can see, so with grading, I will tilt them. T tilde boundary to the end of a sphere of the I, which is also graded, but for any grading, the action is a shift by 2k. So now if I look at the power p, the grading is 2kp. And so, if phi sigma is a Hamiltonian isotopic to the identity, the preferred grading should be a shift with zero. And that is not possible unless if k is equal to zero, if k is equal to zero, for phi sigma to the Hamiltonian isotopic to the identity, this force p to be equal to zero. And so this gives the injectivity. And I told you that if we were working without the Z to decay, namely with K equals zero. So even if they set up the roadmap, they could not have the faithfulness result. And last remark to finish is that this group of people were actually not working on the gradient action on the synthetic side just for that. They were trying to get information on the mirror side. And so there has been some attempt to get a breakthrough action on the mirror side of this extended breakthrough of finite K that failed so far. And maybe this is actually the reason, because the mirror is dependent on the gradient you choose. And so I don't know, we don't have mirrors for all the gradients that we want to put on the synthetic side. So we don't know what would be the mirror for the other case, but that may be a clue where to go. And I should finish that.
Any questions?
What's the relevance of working with the several Ds somehow?
Several.
Do you want to vary?
Because I can do it first. And also, there is a funny thing if you look at the gradient actually, because here for k is non-zero, you get the faithfulness result. But if you study the gradients, the problem shifts. So it's not for k equals zero. So maybe if you manage with the usual gradient but in higher dimension, you could get the mirror that you want and get something on the other side. So if we can do it, and if it's actually worth it. And I mean, it's really getting true. Things are more complicated to write because you have more indices, but the philosophy is really the same.
Any more questions? Okay, that's fine.